based upon American structuralists, they will tell you how can they be connected, how can be they combined, and how can they be replaced. Is clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, moving on.
Yes,
so we have Boas, Sather, and Bloomfield. They are all pioneers of American structuralism, and the towering figure is, of course, the it's Bloomfield. They are the pioneers of American structuralism, and we'll start with Edward Sather. Anyway, he started with his studies in Takelma, which is an American Indian language. Again, we can say that his ideas predated the Sessorian principles of structuralism. For him, what makes him different was, for him, language was a communicative activity. It is a product of history. Then he also explained language in terms of its structure. And he also said that language, structure of language is universal, which was later explained by Chomsky. He said that every language has got a structure. They all have a universal structure. Every language shares a universal structure. Anyway, one more feature that distinguishes Sather from Bloomfield is his emphasis on mentalism. He said that language is mentalistic, or his approach was more mentalistic compared to the mechanistic approach of Bloomfield. Bloomfield's approach was completely mechanistic, while he gave importance to the mindset of the speaker. Anyway, he was part of a hypothesis which is known as Sather work hypothesis that we will discuss towards the end of this blog. Okay. He's one of the pioneers of American structuralism. And his most important idea is he conceived language as having a universal structure. Then also he emphasized on the mentalistic nature of language. Or mentalistic, he also gave importance to the mindset of the speaker. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Shall we move on? Next is Leonard Bloomfield. So his ideas, his theories are related to behaviorism and psychology. Those who studied BA would understand it better. So in his book, Language, he formulated his mechanistic approach that is based on stimulus response. You might have studied stimulus response theory, which is part of behaviorism. And for him, if you have a stimulus that gives rise to a response, if you want an apple, definitely the response would be, if no one is there, you would go and find the apple. You go and get the apple. If someone is there, if Jack, just like Jack and Jill. So if you are Jack and if you are hungry, you would tell Jill that you want an apple. Then that will act as a stimulus to Jill, and Jill will go and fetch that apple for you. That's why we have stimulus S capital, that is the stimulus. Then response, small response, means it acted like a stimulus. That response acted as a stimulus to Jill, and that further came in the form of his reaction.
Yes.
He got the apple for you. That means that is a capital R. That means the enemy stimulus generated the response. S gives rise to the capital R.
Yes, ma'am.
Did you understand the concept? Final product will always be capital R. So this is stimulus response schema. If you are hungry, you would say, this is his idea. If you are hungry, you would say, I am hungry. Or you would go and get some food. These are the responses that can be expected. This is a behaviorist principle. Anyway, he marked a definite shift from mentalism. His ideas marked a definite shift from mentalism and physicalism. Mentalism to physicalism. He completely ignored the mentalistic aspect of the speaker. That is why he is known as an apostle of anti-mentalism. And he placed a very heavy emphasis on objective observation. Objective means the subjectivity was not at all given any importance. So anyway, he also completely ignored the theories of meaning, because he considered meaning as a mentalistic construct. So if you want to consider meaning, you have to consider the culture, you have to consider many other factors. For example, if I tell rose, if I give you the word rose, some of you would be thinking of the flower rose, some of you would be thinking of thinking of the color rose, some would be thinking of the name rose. So it can have multiple significations. So considering meaning as absurd, that is what he thought, Leonard Bloomfield. Okay,
Ma'am,
because meaning, sorry, yes.
what is this mentalism?
Mentalism means you are giving importance to the mindset.
Okay, ma'am.
Signification based on mind, or the response based on mind.
So basically, from mentalism to physicalism means getting some stimulation and then acting on it.
Acting on it, exactly. So it is completely based on behavior. So your mind has no role at all. If you are hungry, you'll go and eat something. So it can be predicted. So he never considers the idea that if you are hungry, you won't say it. You simply suppress the hunger. That is mentalism. You're giving importance to your mind because you understand that there is only a small amount of food and that food is for your kids, so you can't take it. If you consider that way, that is mentalism. You're giving importance to your mind. You're thinking through your thinking. You're giving importance to your thought. But the behaviorism tells you that your response will be in terms of action. That is behaviorism. In case
yes.
of language, if you want to say something, this is how you are going to say it. These are the words that will come out of your mouth. If you're hungry, you would say, I'm hungry.
Ma'am, is it means stimulus and responses constitute a language irrespective of individuals?
Individuals' mindset, exactly.
Okay.
Okay. There is no subjectivity
Ma'am?
At all. That is why it, yes?
Ma'am, what does small r and small s represent in stimulus response schema?
See, That is what I explained through the example of Jack and Jill.
So
if you are hungry, either you will go and get the apple for yourself, or you can tell your mom to get food for you.
Yes.
Anyway, the stimulus is that you are hungry, you need to eat something. Response is you get the food. So either you can take the food directly, or you can tell your mom to get food for you. So the small r is your responses, you are telling your mom. So that response will be acting as a stimulus for your mother. Then finally the response will be, she'll get you food. Okay, clear? Either
okay.
S is equal, S gives rise to R, or S, R, S, capital R. The final product will be capital R. That if you're hungry, you'll eat food. Okay.
Yes,
so there is no possibility like you will suppress your hunger. That is what I told you, that it was completely physical. It was completely objective. Again, another point is that he completely ignored meaning, because for him, meaning was a construct. Meaning is a construct rather, because you can't guess the meaning of a particular word, because that will have infinite implications, that can have many significations based on the mindset of the speaker, based on the culture of the speaker, based on the experience of the speaker, the meaning varies. If I say water, you would be thinking of drinking water. Some of you would be thinking of rain. Some of you would be thinking of a sea. Some of you would be thinking of something else, a picture. So you can have different meanings based on your culture, your experience, and so on. That's why he completely ignored the idea of meaning. So he took meaning as an unobservable mentalistic construct. That is how he took the concept of meaning. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Again, as I told you, he was the father of American structuralism, so he had many followers. And American linguistics were basically American linguistics was basically based on his principles. So they hold on to his principle for quite a long time. They completely ignored meaning. Then they resorted to co-occurrence. Co-occurrence means the combination, the way they can come, the way the elements can come in a language or in a structure. So they focused more on combinations and associations that we will see. So on the basis of distribution of the units of linguistic structure, there are three types of distributional relationship. So I told you, they basically studied the distribution and association. Their ideas are based on distribution and association of the elements in a structure. So So let us see the three types of distribution. First one is complementary distribution, second is contrastive distribution, and third one is free variation. So complementary distribution can be explained using the concept of allophones and allomorphs. That's why I told you that I will take this unit after block 3. Because in order to understand allophones, you should know what are allophones. I hope you know already, you already know what are allophones. Don't you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
The different sound variations of the same phoneme is an allophone. Aspirated version, different aspirated varieties of the same sound is an allophone. So look at the example. In English, the phoneme pa has two variants, the aspirated and the unaspirated. That means when where one unit occurs, the other does not occur. So in the place of an, so whenever pa comes in the initial position and in a stressed position, it is always aspirated. So unaspirated pa will never come in that position. Clear? Similarly, allomorph also. When a word ends with a voiceless sound, and when you are using that ed, when you are using the past tense form of that word, a voiceless sound will always take another voiceless sound. So we'll get cats. And do you remember that cats? S sound. In case of dog, it is Z. In case of horse, it is horses. They are all allomorphs. Allomorphs of the same sound, S. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Is the idea clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So yes, this ma'am. Is complementary distribution. When one unit occurs, the other does not occur in the same place. Next is contrastive distribution. Again, when you you can replace a sound with another sound so that it can produce a change in meaning. Example, when you replace C with P, it becomes pat. So there is a change of meaning. Again, when you replace T with P, it becomes cap instead of cat. Okay, so this is called the contrastive distribution. Complementary distribution means the two units do not occur in the same position. In case of contrastive distribution, when you change a sound, you'll get another word with another meaning. Okay? Minimal pairs means there is change only in case of one sound. That is a minimal pair. For example, cap and cat, it's a minimal pair. Mat and sat, it's a minimal pair. Okay? Clear? Minimal pair means there is a change only in one sound. Two words, there are pairs of words with change only in one sound.
That can be a verb or a consonant.
It can be anything.
Okay, ma'am. I got it. Thank you.
So, complementary distribution. Yeah.
Complementary distribution means, see, when one unit occurs, that means in case of allomorphs and allophones, when where one unit occurs, the other variation doesn't occur in the same place. See, in case of Pat or in case of Peter and police, you will see that both words use the sound P. But in case of police, it is unaspirated. So it is the allophone, the same allophone. That means both are allophonic variations of the same sound P. But in case of Peter, it is aspirated P sound. But in case of police, it is unaspirated.
Okay.
That means we got two sounds, but with different variations of the same sound is used. So that means one unit can occur only under certain conditions. Only if it is unaspirated that we will use the P sound. If it is aspirated, we always use the aspirated version, that is P. The other one is P. Clear?
Clear.
Next, last one is free variation, where unit occur in the same environment along with no change in meaning. Example is either. Either can be either or either. Advertisement can be advertisement or advertisement. So they occur in the same environment along with no change in meaning. Both can be used. That is free variation. That's an example of free variation. Clear?
Yes,
Yes, ma'am.
Can we move on? Any doubt? These three are the important distributional relations according to Seshwar. Bloomfield. Complementary distribution, contrasted distribution, and free variation. Because these are important because they basically focus on the distributional relationship. American structuralism focuses on the distributional relationship, their capacity of the elements for association and distribution. I hope you remember the definition. How can they be combined? How can they be replaced? So these ideas explain you how can they be combined, how can they be replaced. Shall we continue?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So next last one is discovery procedure that I have taken from your textbook essays. So he says that the purpose of a linguist is to come up with some grammar for the language under study. So for that, he should first have a corpus. Corpus is his objective material. What is his objective? So based on his objective, he will come up with a linguistic theory, and that linguistic theory will lay down the rules for the language that will be acted as the grammar for the system. Okay, clear? This has to be the purpose, or this has to be the aim of a linguist. So through using discovery procedure will tell you how to generate grammar. How can you generate grammar for language? First of all, you need to have an objective. With that objective, based on that objective, you will come up with a linguistic theory. And through that linguistic theory, you will generate grammar, rules of grammar. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Moving on, Bloomfieldian methodology. So this is how he distinguished the structure. First one is phonemics. We'll start with phonemics. So this is the first level of operation, phonemics. As you know, it's a sounds. Basic sounds are called, the basic sounds will come under phonemics. In morphemics, we'll see the combination of sounds. Then we have syntax. Syntax, thereby we study the structure of sentence, and finally we will get the discourse that will create larger sentences, or finally we'll get the language for speech. So these are the four layered system according to Bloomfield. This is his method. We'll start with phonemics, then he'll get into morphemes, then we have syntax, and finally we'll have the discourse.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now another important theory coming up, that is IC analysis, immediate constituent analysis. So this was introduced by Bloomfield in 1933. Again, here what we are going to see is we are going to divide the sentence into layers, small layers, and we'll keep on dividing the sentence until we reach the smallest constituent. Smallest constituent means it can be a single word, or can be any meaningful part of the word, can be even an article, can be any meaningful part. Okay. You will reach the smallest divisible word. You keep on dividing a sentence until you get the smallest divisible word. That is called IC analysis. I have given you a sentence, the old man ran away. So the first division would be old man and ran away. The old man, it is a noun phrase. Ran away is the verb phrase, right? The subject is the old man. Ran away is the verb. Okay? Isn't it so?
Yes, ma'am.
So the old man, again, we are going to divide the old man as?
Old and man.
First one would be?
Old. Adjective and noun.
Adjective and noun. Then we'll get article the. Then the final division would be the. The article, old, adjective and man, the noun. Again, the case of ran away, we'll get the division ran.
And
the verb, away is the
preposition.
Away.
Adverb.
It's adverb, exactly. So you get the adverb away. So you got five constituents. One is article, then you got the adjective, then noun, then verb, then adverb. That's how you got the constituents. This is how you divide a sentence. Now let us see. How can you divide a noun phrase? Old men and women. this is a noun phrase, right? It's not a complete sentence, it's just a phrase, old men and women. So the first classification would be old, which is applicable to both men and women. So look at the box. So you can see two divisions possible from this particular sentence. One is old, the adjective old applicable to both men and women. So we'll see the first division based on the adjective applicable to both men and women. Correct? Am I right?
Yes.
Yes.
So look at the divisions. Old, so applicable to men and women. So the second, first in the second box, we saw that men and women are included in a box. Then we will see the next division as men, noun, then conjunction and women, again, noun. Then second division, look at the second box. I see analysis based on another division. Thereby, we see that old is applicable only to men. So the division, we have a different division here, because here old is applicable only to men. So we'll get old men and women. Here the division is different because that adjective is applicable only to men. That's why we have a different division, different type of division. Okay, clear?
Yes, ma'am.
This is IC analysis. So we will see in IC analysis, we will see how can we divide the constituents, and we will finally get the last constituent, that is the immediate constituent, that is to understand the immediate constituents. What are the elements that the sentence constitutes? Next one is generative linguistics. So we were discussing American structuralism. Then now we are going to see generative linguistics. So again, the advocate of generative linguistics, Noam Chomsky. Again, it's a school of thought within linguistics. It is he who comes up with the concept of generative grammar. His important book is Syntactic Structures. And he is famous for his TG grammar, that is Transformational Generative Grammar. So these are the concepts which he is associated with. Generative linguistics, Chomsky's ideas about language, and pre-structured grammar, PSG, that is another extension of IC analysis. Then we have TG grammar. He came up with TG grammar to replace pre-structured grammar. We will soon see how it is. Chomsky's ideas about language. This is how he defines language. It's a set of sentences, each finite in length and constructed out of a finite set of elements. Again, it is a system represented in the mind. Again, that is very important. It is a system represented in the mind or brain of a particular individual. So you could see that he gave importance to the mind of the reader. Sorry, mind of the speaker. Then again, he had always wanted to come up with the idea of universal grammar. Earlier we saw that Sapper stated that you can see certain elements which are universal, but he always wanted to come up with an idea called universal grammar. So what do you mean by universal grammar? Universal grammar means the rules that are common to all human languages, the rules or principles which are common to every language. So if you study Malayalam or if you study Hindi, there are many common elements, there are many common rules. And if you study the rules of every language, you will see there are certain rules which are common to each and every language. So he thought if he studies those common rules, he will be able to come up with a universal grammar. So once you understand the universal grammar, you can approach each and every language. Okay. So every language...
Man. Sorry. Man.
Yes.
Is it possible to develop a universal grammar? Is anyone tried to develop it?
Chomsky did try.
Developed a universal grammar.
He tried to come up with something called universal grammar. He tried, that was his objective.
Is he successful in it?
No, he wasn't successful, but still, because he couldn't study all the languages. That is again a very difficult task. But he tried to come up with certain ideas.
But in Indian languages, it's possible. The structure of our languages are same. But
there are certain things, at least a classification, the division of elements as nouns, verbs, and those things are similar.
Ma'am, okay. In every language also, will there have... is a There is a very good similarity of past tense and present tense in Hindi also. It's same in both the languages.
In Indian languages it is possible, but there are languages like haiku and also I don't remember the name of the language, but there is a language whereby those people do not have any distinction as past tense and present tense. So they don't have past tense at all. They don't have expressions like yesterday or last year. They don't have anything that they can show the past form. So they don't have any past form at all. So there is no division of time as past, present and future. Rather, they consider language time as something which is flowing.
Which language is that?
I think it's a Redinian language. It's coming. We'll see.
Okay.
So the concept of universal grammar, whereby he tried to come up with a common universal grammar so that you can study all human languages. Then again, that is based on his idea that human beings share part of their knowledge of language, which is universal grammar. So we all have a knowledge of language, that is slang, which is universal. Okay, existing as part of language competence, or we can rather say that it is part of our lang. So we all share our knowledge of language, which is universal. Because we follow certain rules, whatever be the language that we use language based on certain rules, and those rules can be universal. So every human beings know a set of principles that apply to all languages and parameters that vary within clearly defined limits from one language to another. So when you study a second language, you will first try to compare that language with your language. Then you will try to find out the divisions, what all ways this language differ from your language. So that is what is meant by parameters that vary within clearly defined limits. So you will understand that. So in this particular, in case of this language, this is the structure which it follows, which is different from the structure of my language, which follows this particular structure. Okay. That the speaker is already aware of. He knows a set of principles that apply to all languages. At least he would know that this division of elements as nouns, words, nouns, verbs, and so on are common to all languages. Because in every language, people will be given a name. At least that is common. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So the use of proper nouns or common nouns are common. I'm just giving an example. Then we can say that universal grammar is an attempt to integrate grammar, mind and language. Here he is focusing on not just on the rules of grammar, rather he is also focusing on the mind and language. That is what differentiates Chomsky from other American structuralists. Let us see his ideas about syntax. Again, he says that language is structure dependent, just like all other structuralists. Syntax again he endorses this point also, that is more than meaning. He also doesn't consider meaning that much. So rather he thinks that language relies on the structural relationship in the sentence rather than on the sequence of words. So it is basically a relationship between the structure, it's not just a sequence of words, rather the relationship, the signification is based on the structure, not the words. Okay, again he doesn't give importance to meaning. Example, the man who stole is John. Is the man who stole John? Which one is correct? Here the meaning is based not on the combination of words, rather it is based on the structure. Only if you ask this particular question that the sentence will be correct. Otherwise you won't be able to give the correct signification. Is the man who stole is John? Can you ask the question like that?
No.
Which one is correct?
The first one.
The man who was told is John.
Yeah.
Is the man who was told John? It's also, but last one is not a person. Is the man who told is John? It's not a correct way. So we understood that it is dependent on structure. The signification is dependent on structure, not the words. Okay. Then syntax, then we came to the conclusion that it is more than meaning. So there can be sentences There can be well-formed sentences without meaning, colorless, clean ideas, sleep furiously. Again, it is meaning deprived of inner logic. See, look at the first sentences. Colorless, green ideas, sleep furiously. It is a perfectly complete sentence, because colorless, green ideas, there is nothing wrong with the sentence. Colorless, green ideas, sleep furiously. Then in that case, we might think that, how can it convey a sense then? If it is not just about meaning. Then, so in order to understand whether this is a possible combination, you have to ask the native speaker. That is what he has to tell you. In order to understand whether a language, whether a particular sentence is acceptable or not, you have to ask the native speaker. If it is acceptable to the native speaker, this is logically correct. So there also he says that you should not rely on the meaning. The meaning is decided by the people who use the language.
Yes, okay? The native people actually.
Native people. So it's a well-formed sentence without meaning. Look at the second sentence example. Syntax as well as meaning deprived of inner logic. In the second sentence, there is no syntax, there is no semantics. Ideas furiously, green, colorless, sleep. But the first one is structurally correct. The second one lacks both logic as well as syntax. Then Chomsky's ideas, competence and performance, which is similar to Lang and Parrot. Almost is similar to Lang and Parrot. So it is he who came up with this idea of competence and performance. Competence is your knowledge of language. Isn't it just like Lang? Your knowledge, your unconscious knowledge of the language, about sounds, meanings and syntax. Every human child is born with an LAD, language acquisition device. So he has that idea of language. He has that knowledge of language. He has the knowledge of the structure of language.
Mainly mother tongue.
Mother tongue.
Yes.
So every child is born with an LAD, language acquisition device. So when he is exposed to a particular language, of course that will start working. The device is there within you. Once you start giving something, when you start giving the input, definitely it starts working.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, that is how it becomes part of your experience. Then next one is performance. How do you put that knowledge into use? That is performance. It is similar to Lang and Parrot. Competence and performance.
Yes.
When we term these ideas under Chomsky, it becomes competence and performance. Then models of grammar. Then these are the three important models of grammar proposed by Chomsky. Finite state grammar, free structure grammar, TEG grammar. Second, the free structure grammar and transformational generative grammar are very important to us.
The American structuralism, if the question is coming, then Chomsky also will write.
Yeah. See, you just mentioned Chomsky, but I think he'll be asked as a separate question. Because you will be asked to write about generative grammar or Chomsky.
Yes, ma'am.
If they ask you, but he is also a part of American structuralism, even though he came up with different ideas. So you can just mention Chomsky. It's a way of conclusion.
Yes, about a little bit you can write.
Later, Chomsky came up with something called a TEG grammar, transformational generative grammar.
Yes, ma'am.
Which were different in many aspects, like then you can write down a few points.
Yes, ma'am.
Actually, ICE analysis and phrase structure grammar are connected. Phrase structure grammar is an extension of ICE analysis by Bloomfield. While he uses a tree diagram, he uses an inverted tree diagram. That is the difference. Chomsky used inverted diagram, tree diagram. See, he started with revision. Rather, he started with the rules first. Then he went on to label the sentence. But Bloomfield started with the sentence. Then he later only he labeled it.
Yes, ma'am.
That is the difference. So one's approach was deductive, while the other approach was inductive. You will see that soon. Models of grammar. So these are the three models of grammar he introduced. Finite state grammar, free structure grammar, and TEG grammar. So the last two are important to us. Free structure grammar. So he gave us rules for determining the structure of phrases. Again, so with these rules, if you have the rules with you, you can generate a lot of sentences from a small number of rules. That is the difference between Chomsky and Bloomfield. Bloomfield gave you a sentence, then he divided the sentence into small constituents. But once you have the rules, once you know the rules, you'll be able to generate sentences of your own. That was Chomsky's idea. Why do you need to take an example, then start labeling? then why can't you start with rules first? Then you can generate many sentences out of the rules. Clear? Is the idea clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Then the structure of a phrase will consist of one or more constituents in a certain order. So you can divide a sentence into different phrases, and each phrase will have one or more constituents in a certain order. What would be that order? For example, in the case of noun phrase, you will have an article followed by an adjective, then followed by a noun. That is how the order of a phrase would be in case of a noun phrase. So you will see the example. Some words seem to belong together. The crazy man is jumping off the bridge. Look at the constituents here. Let's take the first constituent, noun phrase. Let's first divide the sentence into a phrase, noun phrase and verb phrase. What is the noun phrase there?
The crazy man.
Exactly. Or we rather divide the sentence into subject and predicate. That is the general division that we all know, the subject and the predicate. Here the subject is the crazy man, and is jumping off the bridge is the predicate. So now we are going to an advanced level. We label it as noun phrase and verb phrase. That which acts as a noun will be the noun phrase, and the part of the group of words which constitute the verb part would be the verb phrase. So the crazy man, in the crazy man, we will see the article, the crazy adjective, and man, the noun. Similarly, in jumping off the bridge also, you will see again verb auxiliary, then jumping off, it's a phrasal verb, then the article, then bridge noun. Again, in the last division, in the second division, you will again get a noun phrase. What is a noun phrase in that verb phrase?
Bridge.
The bridge. Again, you get another noun phrase, right? The bridge. That is now the noun phrase. So here noun phrase comes as part of a verb phrase. That is, he is jumping off the bridge. Let's take another example. Phrase structure rules and tree diagram. See, if you know the rules, I told you that you will be able to write a sentence. Noun phrase can be determiner plus noun, and prepositional phrase can be a preposition plus a noun phrase. So noun phrase can be determiner plus noun, and a prepositional phrase can be a preposition plus noun phrase. See, I have taken only a noun phrase here. So that big noun phrase can be divided as a noun phrase plus a prepositional phrase. Do you get the idea?
Yes.
For example, I am taking the example of the boy in the yard is my friend. The boy in the yard called me. Isn't it a complete sentence? Isn't it a complete sentence? So I'm taking only the first part, so that it's a noun phrase. The boy in the yard, it's a noun phrase. I'm again dividing the noun phrase as noun. So we get the noun phrase as noun phrase is equal to the noun phrase, the boy, plus prepositional phrase. Prepositional phrase means the phrase, it starts with a preposition. Here the preposition is in. So we get the answer. It's a prepositional phrase is in the yard. So noun phrase is equal to another noun phrase plus prepositional phrase. So here we get the noun phrase as the article, the, and boy. So look at the division there. Determiner, noun, prepositional phrase. So determiner is again the article. It determines the noun. How many? So there is only the boy. So a and the, this, that, they're all determiners that determine the number. They're called determiners because it determines the noun. Clear?
Okay, ma'am.
So the boy in the yard can be divided as determiner plus noun plus prepositional phrase. Again, when you divide the prepositional phrase, you get preposition in plus another noun phrase, the yard. Again, that noun phrase consists of a determiner and another noun, yard. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So you have generated the rules first. Then based on these rules, you can generate as many sentences as you want. So you can generate other sentences which follow the same order. The boy in the yard, the girl in the class, the lady in the hotel, the man in the crowd. So you can generate many sentences. Is it clear? But in the case of immediate constituent analysis, in the case of ICE analysis, we first started with the sentence instead of the rules. That is the difference between phrase structure, grammar, and immediate constituent analysis. Isn't it an inverted diagram? Again, another example. I hope you understood it now. See, first one, we have seen a noun phrase. This is a case of a verb phrase. So here, verb phrase is equal to verb plus noun phrase plus another prepositional phrase. Take the last sentence, verb phrase, take your sister to the library. What is the order there? Take your sister, say, you please take your sister to the library. If that is a sentence, you take your sister to the library as a verb phrase. The whole sentence, the whole group of words is a verb phrase, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Then you are again going to divide the verb phrase as verb plus another noun phrase. Your sister is another noun phrase plus to the library. It's a prepositional phrase. So you got verb phrase here means verb plus noun phrase plus prepositional phrase. Right? Am I right?
Yes.
Again, noun phrase here is your sister. That is a combination of a determiner plus noun. Again, to the library is a combination of preposition to plus another noun phrase, the library. Again, that noun phrase consists of a determiner, the plus noun library. Is it getting clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
I hope all of you understood phrase structure grammar.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, moving on. So these are the phrase structure rules. Sentence can be combination of, sentence is a combination of a noun phrase plus verb phrase. Noun phrase, as we saw in the earlier cases, it is a combination of a determiner plus noun, or it can be also pronoun. Then VP, verb phrase can be a combination of verb plus noun phrase plus prepositional phrase, even adverb. Then prepositional phrase is equal to preposition plus noun phrase, and adjective phrase is equal to, or adverb phrase is equal to adverb plus preposition. We'll see the examples. See, this is the example given in your textbook. Sentence is equal to noun phrase plus verb phrase. The man hit the ball. You can see the rules. Noun phrase is equal to article plus noun, the man. Then verb phrase is equal to verb plus noun phrase. Here the verb here is hit plus noun phrase is equal to the ball. So the ball is again a combination of determiner plus noun. Instead of article, you can write determiner, D-E-T. Okay. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Clear, ma'am.
But there are certain limitations with phrase structure grammar. Anyway, the rules are mostly context-free. You won't be able to always consider the signification. They're context-free. You can generate as many sentences with this order. Then again, the rules explain intra-sentence constituent elements, but not inter-sentence relation. That means you can explain the sentences, the relation of the sentence, relations of words within a sentence, but you won't be able to explain the connection of different sentences, as in the case of combining sentences with conjunctions. Okay? You'll be able to explain the sentence, the connection of words within a sentence, but you won't be able to explain the connection of words within two sentences, or when you connect a sentence with another sentence, you won't be able to explain the relationship. Similarly, ambiguous sentences cannot be explained. For example, there are sentences whereby you comes as a subject. So for example, get up, shut up, get out. When you make these type of sentences, it is so ambiguous because there is no subject at all. Even though the subject is understood, we don't use the sentence. We don't use it in a speech. So that it is very difficult to explain these kind of sentences, imperative sentence. Clear? In imperative sentences, there won't be subject because it is understood. The subject is already understood. Because the subject is always you. That kind of sentences cannot be explained using phrase structure grammar. Because we have the formula that sentence is equal to noun phrase plus verb phrase. But since we don't find noun phrase, we won't understand the pattern of the sentence. Clear? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So these problems were solved with next step, that is transformational generative grammar. So there were many drawbacks for this phrase structure grammar. So he came up with transformational generative grammar to address these drawbacks. Let us see TG grammar. Shall we see TG grammar? Do we have time? Let's see. Deep and short surface. I'll take some more time. Deep and short surface structures. So again, this is a concept by Chomsky. Syntactic relationship have two levels of representation, as we have seen, and as we have seen in the case of competence and performance, there is a surface structure and there's a deep structure. Deep structure is the underlying representation. So you know that you know the basic structure of a sentence, and you generate new sentences out of that basic sentence, and that basic sentence is called a deep structure. And sentences that you generate out of this basic sentence are called sentences which belong to deep structure. For example, if I make a positive sentence, I know the order, that is subject verb. I know. Okay, this is the sentence I know. But when I want to make a negative sentence, I make a sentence out of this deep structure. So I will say I don't know. Even when I want to make a question, I will say, do I know? That they are all structures which I have created out of this deep structure. Is the idea clear? So negative sentences, questions, all these are, then again passive voice, all these are created out of this deep structure. So there is an underlying structure, and from that we create new structures, and that underlying structure is the deep structure, and that derived representation and the surface that we derived out of this deep structure is the surface structure. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, deep structure is an abstract level of structural organization, but surface structure can be derived from deep structure by transformation, like passivization, forming questions, negatives. They are all derived out of this deep structure. Okay. So these are all examples. Charlie broke the window. How they are related? Let us look at the connection. The window was broken by Charlie broke the window. It is the deep structure. The window was broken by Charlie. Again, it's the surface structure. Was the window broken by Charlie? Another surface structure. Charlie who broke the window, it's not complete. Then we can say that Charlie didn't break the window. It is another surface structure. So difference in their surface structure is equal to difference in syntactic form. So when I created different structures, there was a difference in their forms also, but they have a same underlying structure. That means Charlie, then the verb break, and the noun the window, the object the window. Is it clear? And the sentence, yes, is in tenth past tense. Charlie broke the window. This is the basic structure. From that I could derive passive voice, then negative sentence and a question also. Did Charlie break the window? Charlie didn't break the window. The window was broken by Charlie. All these surface structures were derived out of the deep structure. Charlie broke the window. Next is TG grammar. Do we have time to start TG grammar? Shall we deal it in the next class?
Okay, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am.
Next class, I will also start block 2. It is history of language. I won't be taking too much time for it. Once I finish it, I'll move on to it. But the only thing is that it is quite boring, I should tell you, because there are it is easy, but the only thing is that it's very boring, because old English spelling, the changes in spelling, the changes in grammar and so on are not that easy to digest, because they are old English and the words are not that familiar to us. So you may find it as very boring, but I'm really helpless. Only thing you can do is so you can read it and come for the class.
Ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, yes. When will be the next class?
Maybe next Saturday and Sunday.
Time?
Same time. I think 4 to 6 will be followed.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
It's what we are planning. I don't think the time has been fixed, but I have told coordinator that next week will be okay for me. Maybe she'll fix it same time. I don't know. Let's see.
Okay. Ma'am, what was statistic block 9?
That also I'll take. Okay, I'll take stylistics, syntax and stylistics, both blocks. I won't be dealing the other blocks.
Okay, ma'am. Other we can
understand. That is easy to understand. Only that syntax part is a bit difficult. When stylistics is easy, so syntax is the syntax is a bit difficult part. All the rest are very easy. Don't you find it so?
Yeah.
Syntax is also easy for those who know grammar. Many of you are very well versed in grammar, because when I ask, you were giving response, so I understood that many of you have very good foundation for grammar, so those people won't find it difficult at all, because it's very easy.
Yeah, ma'am.
Others who have got some problem with grammar would find it a bit difficult, because it's basically about grammar. It is syntax, that means structure. That's all about grammar.
Ma'am, which topics will you be dealing with in the next class?
Second block, that is history of language. That's why what I told you, it's going to be a bit boring. Okay. Because
it's
changes in Old English spelling, grammar and vocabulary. So if you read it and come for the next class, it will be easier for me.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Then thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.